God is good and all the time. Amen. We welcome everyone who has come today, maybe for the first time, or maybe your friends invited you for the first time this weekend. You're from Tri-Cities. You are our honored guest. And we also welcome all those guests who have come from afar, some who flew, a young lady who flew all the way from Florida, some who drove from California, some who came from Canada and other states. And so those who are watching us on live, I've even got some messages, people watching us in Mexico and some other places and stuff. So we're really grateful for every person that is here. Amen. Let's give the Lord a round of applause for His goodness, His mercy. We already have heard yesterday about the War of the Worlds. And this morning about us being the ambassadors of the kingdom of God. And I'm just going to ride the same wave that they did, present to you a few thoughts about the same thing. In our church, we just changed titles. It's the same thing and stuff. So, and that's why it's so interesting. Church, when it's a revelation, it could only be interesting when it's a revelation. And it could be the same thing, just change the titles and the scriptures and the stories. But it's the same message, the message, the gospel of the kingdom of God. It's the best message, never gets old, because it holds answers for our personal lives. It holds answers and it's practical. It's not something about the planets. It's about something our planet and our world and something that deals with the personal issues that we struggle with and gives us hope and also gives us change. Amen. Without further ado, we will open Matthew chapter 11 and verse 12. It says the following, from the time of John the Baptist, begun preaching until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing and violent people are attacking it. 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 8. So David recovered all that the Amalekites of chapter 30 verse 8. That's probably the wrong verse over there. I'll read it just from my Bible. Chapter 30, verse 8. So David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And the Lord answered him, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all. Somebody say amen. If we will go into the Old Testament is the combination of books about the stories leading up to Jesus. There is two main kings. King Saul, who is the first king, and the scripture indicates to us he was chosen by people. And the king after him was the King David, who was chosen by God. And King Saul, he was a taker. Even when the description was written about his kingdom, it will say, he will take your daughters, he will take your possessions, he will take your lands, he will take your taxes, he will take. But David, from the beginning to the end of his life, we saw always David gave. He gave his life to trying to rescue the sheep, to trying to rescue Goliath, and to trying to rescue people from the Goliath, and continued on to risk his life to protect the people of God. And we see that King Saul, he was disobedient to God. And in the beginning, God causes him to lose a dynasty. That means that even when King Saul would finish his reign, his after him, none of the people with Saul's name will be able to occupy the throne. And then Saul continues to disobey and God says, not only you're losing your dynasty, I'm gonna dethrone you. And he actually was dethroned for not executing God's judgment on Amalekites. And God came through Samuel and says, you're no longer a king. Yet, King Saul still continued to rule as though he was a king. God removed kingdom from him. Yet, he still exercised authority. He still intimidated people. And people were still afraid and people were still under his jurisdiction. As this was going on, that King Saul, who was no longer king, though he was controlling people, on the other side, there was a young man named David who was legitimate king, but he didn't have a throne. And he developed a little huddle, a little group that combined themselves with David, and they said, we will be with him. And they lived in exile. They were persecuted. They were in hardships. And eventually King David, who had no throne, got the throne, and Saul experienced his last defeat, where he And those who were with him not only lost the dynasty, lost the crown, but they lost their lives. That's exactly what's happening right now. Kingdom of Satan is like the kingdom of Saul. He was with God, but he was disobedient. And God threw him away from heaven. Defeat number one. And then God didn't give him an option of repentance. Sometimes we don't think of that. That with us, when we sin, God gives us an option. Chance number two. And most of us, we used up chances 20,000. Satan didn't have an option. That means he has no dynasty. He has no future reconciliation with God. God says, you're done. Then God sent his son on the cross, and Jesus disarms Satan. Not only in heaven Satan was defeated, he was defeated on earth. So now Satan roams around the earth without a crown, though he still rules. And though he still has, quote unquote, majority under his spell. Just like Saul, who terrorized people, lied to people about David, saying David is a bad guy, and kept people under his regime, threatened people. People in their hearts wanted the King David. They loved David because he was for them. But under the oppression of Saul, they served him, a king without a crown. And that's exactly what's happening today. Majority of the world today are under the spell, and the Bible says under the sway of the evil one. In their hearts, people believe there is a God. In their hearts, there is a yearning to be with someone who created you. But because of this oppression, and because Satan pretends to be a king and he's no longer is, the Bible says that he is the prince of the air, but we know that Jesus Christ, before he left heaven, he said, all the authority is mine. That means Satan has been fired. He's running like a chicken without a head. He's still controlling the earth. He's still keeping under his terror, but he has been defeated. Now, what I want to present to us today is also, I want to remind you of Satan's future. Why? Because Satan will remind you of your past, and you have to be sure of his future. You have to remind him. Why? Because see, Satan will remind you of your past, and your past is a fact, so is his future. He will say, you did it. You're like, that's right. And guess what's going to happen to you? Wait until your future comes. Your future is nothing compared to my past. The Bible says that the kingdom of God will be preached and then the end will come. When I was younger, that word scared me. Because what that meant to me as a young person is that there comes a time, a last person gets saved, and then we all gonna get shot by the devil, and the devil's gonna like torment and hurt us and everything. But if you read Book of Revelation, you see that the end doesn't come for us. The end comes for the devil. God doesn't let the devil go to hell without first bringing hell on the devil. Everything about Book of Revelation, you see the first, it starts with seals, then goes to trumpets, and then goes to bowls. And that's those verses in the Bible. You see the horses, you see the earth being turned down, and you always see this at the end of every single wrath of God, is that God was aiming all of his wrath on Satan, not in hell, on earth. Because God will do to Satan what happened to Saul. He will experience his final defeat on this earth. Satan's kingdom is popular, but not going to be popular very long. Even when Saul was popular, inside he was terrorized. The Bible says inside Saul, during his last battle, he went to a witch doctor and he was scared for his life. And the Bible tells us that Satan also is scared, knowing his time is short. Though he has everything under his fingertips, inside he knows God is right, and he is like a race car racing really fast to a cliff. His kingdom, no matter how popular it is going to be doomed. And the more people he gets under his fingertips, the more suffering he will receive. Now my message, our message today is this. We don't feel sorry for the devil. I would not mind if God will increase the heat. We just want the HD version of it. When we go to heaven, we just want to watch it live. When Satan and all of his minions go under heavy, heavy suffering, I'm sure it will be a relief. This problem happens is not when Saul was dying. It's the fact that David's friend was with Saul. And David didn't talk him out of it. The challenge happens today is that Satan's kingdom will be crushed. But there are many people who are your friends, who are our family members, who are not fighting with the kingdom of David that is not so popular maybe in the eyes of the culture, but it's destined to rule the world. But they are with the kingdom of the enemy under his spell. They are still fighting for the kingdom of the enemy. And when the enemy will be punished, and he will, unfortunately, many of them are right with the enemy. And our task today is to talk out every Jonathan, every child of God, every person to tell them, Saul is going down, don't go down with him. He is popular today, but he is going to be defeated once again. Look at the devil. If the devil tells you, oh, you're a failure, you're like, Satan, look at your own record. You got kicked out of heaven. You got beaten by Jesus. And Jesus is already saying you're headed straight to hell. And before you go to hell, he'll send hell on you. You are the biggest failure. That's why you're speaking out of the abundance of your own heart. I am not a failure. I'm a winner in Jesus Christ. The enemy will be defeated. Can somebody say amen? Our message today is this. Don't follow what's popular. Follow what has future. Don't follow what's popular. Follow what has future. Today it's popular to be this and that. If you follow popularity, you will find yourself always on the side of the history. Christianity wasn't popular when they would crucify Christians upside down on the crosses. When any dilemma that would happen in the Roman kingdom, they would always blame it on Christians because Christians wouldn't fight back. They would throw them to lions anytime a storm, anytime a tsunami or an earthquake would happen. Guess who they would blame it on? Christians. It wasn't popular to be a Christian because you would lose a job. This wasn't about if you become a Christian, you have to stop smoking. This was losing your job, losing your family and losing your life. And it wasn't popular, but people followed Christ just like people followed David when it wasn't popular. 300 years later, and Christianity becomes popular. 300 years later, and today Nero, who was the emperor throwing Christians into the lion's dens, people call their dogs Nero. And we build cathedrals in the name of Peter. Because everything shifts. Popularity doesn't last. What God says lasts. God created this earth, and what he says will last. Roman kingdom couldn't last. Our kingdom, American kingdom, every Egyptian kingdom, we have to understand communism, fascism, Nazism, none of these things supposed to be where our loyalty is anchored in. We love our nation. We love our government. We pray for our kings. We pray for our presidents. But we must understand we belong to a kingdom that cannot be shaken. It's the kingdom of God. When laws are made in the land, when corruption comes in, when depravity, when boundaries are being washed, and today it is popular to distance yourself from the Christianity and from the teachings of Jesus. Today it is popular not to hang out around Jesus because Jesus has a bad name that was given to him by King Saul. King Saul created a bad reputation for David, saying he wants to kill me. He is this and that. But David's men were with David when it was not popular, and when David became a king, and he did become a king, they were heroes. There's coming a day where the Lord Jesus Christ will be the only king the earth will acknowledge. The Bible says the nations will come and bring their glory into Jerusalem and bow before Jesus. The day is coming where people willingly and unwillingly will confess him and bow their knees before him. Jesus, son of David, will be the king. David was a king and Saul perished same thing will happen to the kingdom of heaven. Can somebody say amen? I want to encourage you. You are on a winning kingdom. You are in a kingdom that has a future. You are in a kingdom that has a legitimate king. You are in a kingdom that has power. And in this kingdom, we have to advance. When David was in the exile, when David was persecuted, when David was not acknowledged, when David wasn't popular, when being aligned to David meant you could lose your life, priests who only sheltered him and gave him bread and a Goliath sword lost their lives. They didn't even, were not with him. They just helped him. They lost their lives. That's how serious it was to be with David. And so it's happening in our culture today. People who align themselves with God, they begin to experience even some hardships. And so many people who come to Jesus thinking that Jesus will only make your life better, I have a news for you. Will you be willing to follow Jesus if your life gets complicated? The day we are coming into, young man and young woman, following Jesus will make your life complicated. Yes, it will bring you freedom from demons. Yes, it will bring you freedom from disease. And yes, it will fill you with the power that is greater than any other power. But at the same time, it will create you enemies with the King Saul, his agents, and his agenda. And if you're not going to be willing to embrace controversy, if you're not going to be willing to have some haters in your life, and to have some people who don't like you, don't understand you, and don't appreciate you, you might abandon the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to make a decision today, like the three Hebrew boys. Our God that we serve, He is able to save us from this furnace. But if He doesn't save us, oh great King, let it be known to you. To your gods, we will not bow. And your idols, we will not worship. If you come to Jesus only because He will put a smile on your face, but you don't make a decision, He is the King, legitimate King, and in the history He will always win, and that's why I stake my life at Him. You will be driven away by the popularity of King Saul. Make a decision today, like the three Hebrew boys. I am with God for a long haul. I am with God for a journey. I am with God when it's good, and I am with God when it's not. Can somebody say amen? When David was in the exile, King Saul was headed to this last battle where he would be lost. And David was also experiencing his greatest victory. David's greatest victory happened when he attacked Amalekites. He received so much plunder that it was enough for him, for his friends, for his associates, and for his connections. He had so much plunder, he was shipping it off to different tribe leaders and different people. He was loaded. At the same time as Saul is headed into disaster, David is headed into his greatest victory. I want to tell you something, that at this day and at this age, as the kingdom of darkness is headed into their worst days, we as the kingdom of God, with our King, we are headed into our best days. We are headed into revival. We are headed into the salvation of souls. We are headed into the people being healed, people being delivered from demons, raised from the dead, cleansed from leprosy, lame walking, blind seeing, deaf hearing, and people praising the name of our God. Can somebody say amen? But we must understand that before this great day came, we see that something else came first. The scripture says in 1 Samuel chapter 30, when David came to the city of Ziklag, he saw that the city was completely burned down. His women were taken captives. Possession was kidnapped. Everything was removed. And the men who were with David, who sacrificed their life to be with David, now feel like they just got ripped off. Now they feel like they just got tricked. Now they're not only there in exile, they are completely robbed. And the Bible says they got so depressed that they were thinking not to leave David, which would be bad, to kill him. Now, you know you're depressed when you want to kill the head. And that's exactly what happened with them. Maybe you are here this evening and you've been following Jesus. And you already paid the price to follow Jesus. There's some cost that was involved in that. And maybe following Jesus made things worse. Maybe your family, instead of getting better, has gotten worse. Maybe the health, instead of improving, deteriorated. Maybe your finances, instead of going up, you lost the job. And maybe that person that you really liked and you had these visions and prophetic words that they will be the one, that one is moved on with someone else than you. Maybe your dreams, they crashed and your expectations failed. And today you are in a place of extreme anxiety and depression. And when you read that verse where the Bible says they were so exhausted from weeping and tired, and you're looking at that and you may say, that is me. And you are beginning to doubt God, or maybe you're beginning to say, you know what, I'm gonna go look for help somewhere else. I'm gonna ask you, please hold. I had the opportunity to pray for one young lady this morning who, when her life broke apart, she, instead of going to God and waiting on God, she says, I'm gonna go try other sources, and starts going to other religions to try to look for help. And the interesting part is things only got worse. And she said, Vlad, you have to understand, I didn't mean to abandon God, I just needed help. And I asked her, have you ever been thirsty? She said, of course. Have you ever been thirsty and you had no drinking water in your house? She said, yes. I said, to what extent does your thirst push you personally to drink toilet water? She said, personally, Pastor, I would never drink it because though it looks clean, it has bacteria. And I told her this, no matter how depressed, no matter how discouraged and how difficult your situation is, you must understand the only chance your situation has is with David, not without him. With God, there is hope. Without him, your situation is hopeless. And somebody say amen. And David encourages his men, and he says, guys, I know you want to cut my head off and move forward, but I want to tell you something, that's not the way. You can kill me, but the problem will remain. You can walk away from the church. You can take the Bible and throw it away out of your house or out of your car because the person you prayed for cancer, they didn't get healed. You can give up your faith completely because your dreams did not come true. But I'm going to tell you something, it won't change your situation. Don't give up too soon. Because the kingdom that is right now seems to be suffering in your life, it's only temporary. We see in David's story, when David says, no, guys, I am not going to let you kill me, and I am not going to kill you, we're going to find a way, few things happen. If you're taking notes, write few of those things happen, because they will happen in your life and in my life, how we can advance the kingdom in our life. First, what happens is God gives David a promise. God tells David, you will go, you will find those losers, and you will get everything back that they have given you, that they have taken from you. The first thing that everything starts with is with the vision. The vision is where the victory begins, and the vision is when we, victory starts with the vision and not with improvements. Changes in your life begin with the vision, not with improvements. Many times people, when they have a problem, they come to God panicking. They come to God throwing a fit, thinking the louder you scream, the louder you threaten God, or somehow think that God will fall from his throne or get a migraine headache because you're telling him that you're going to leave him and talk bad about him. God seen Hitler and didn't fall from his throne. Panicking, falling into depression to try to move God is not what moves him. Asking God, if you don't change my life, I won't follow you. That's not where your problem will change. Where your problem will change, and this might sound weird, is you have to get a different vision. God doesn't do miracles first until He does miracles in your head. God does a vision inside of your head. And I know David could have said, I don't need the prophecy. I don't need the promise. I don't need the vision. David, that's exactly what you need, because you're a depressing cycle inside. Your problem is not just on the outside, David. The problem got inside already. The problem is inside. You're suicidal. My friends, if the problem you're having in your life has gotten inside of you, I can assure you, most likely God will not be answering your prayer by fixing your problem. He'll be first trying to fix you. And you will push His hands out and say, God, that's not the right address. Go to my husband. He fixed my husband. He's the alcoholic. Go to my wife. She is the one that talks too much. Go to my crazy kids. They're the ones smoking weed. And God will come to you and says, and you are the one who is depressed, suicidal, and panicking. You are the one that I want to first fix. Can somebody say amen? God will start with giving you a vision. He did it to David. He didn't bring the women back. He didn't throw golden coins from heaven. He threw him a word and said, David, you will go and you will win. You know what happened with that promise? David's face changed. And the Bible says he strengthened himself in the Lord. Nothing changed. Nothing changed. Not one miracle happened yet. A son didn't come back home. Money were not found. But what happened is vision came inside. And with the vision came hope. With the vision came depression was pushed out. With the vision came confidence. Everything will be all right in my life in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen? God has brought you into this place tonight to give you, first of all, a vision. That your situation will change. Don't wait to have a vision when you see a change. Receive a vision and then the change will come. When our church started, and most of you heard this morning when Martin was talking about it, our church did not start with powerful preachers. Our church did not start it with these wonderful voices that we hear today, beautiful media or wonderful building or wonderful strategy or services. Our church started with a man who, first of all, from God, did not receive gifts or did not receive money, who did not receive from God souls. He received from God a vision. He didn't receive from God English language. He received a vision. And when the vision rested inside of him, that vision attracted people. That vision attracted finances. That vision pulled things out of teenagers that everybody said nothing will ever amount to them. That vision pulled talents into the church. And that vision is pulling people out of Texas, out of New York, out of Florida. That vision pulled you here. When you're depressed, when you're suicidal, and you're blaming it on your problems, you are a magnet to problems in your life. You can pray until you lose your voice for God to change your situation. But until God changes the vision on inside, you are only going to be attracting problems. If God heals you of the sickness, you'll get another one. If God fixes this financial problem, you'll find another financial problem. Because the problem is also with a magnet. Change your vision. Begin to expect different things. Begin to anticipate different things. Begin to speak different things. Vision is what you see. It's what you think, what you feel, and what you speak. When the vision came in the heart of our pastor, it drew things out of us. I remember, you know, my pastor, he grew up more in a church that believes to worship God, like we worship, good people worship. And I grew up in a church where we were not taught to worship God like this. We were worshiping God in a very different way. But because of that vision, all of the hindrances, all of the barriers were pushed out, and eventually people start coming to Jesus. Who are Hispanic, who are American, who are businessmen, who are drug addicts, different men and different women start coming to Jesus because of this vision. Your vision has to be clear. Many people's vision is blurry. I remember I talked to one, a wonderful youth pastor, friend of mine. I asked him, what is the vision you have for your youth ministry? And he used this long Shakespeare's almost a sandwich, statement. It sounded like sandwich. Where I want the believers who are reigning in Christ to begin to be sanctified, to reach their neighbors for the glory of Almighty God, for the future coming of the saints and the rulership of the earth. And he used these fancy words. I'm like, are you the only one in your church who can repeat that? He's like, yes. I was like, I have a feeling that nobody else in the church knows the vision. He's like, well, they know we are here to worship God. That's not a vision. That's why you are breathing, but that's not why you are living. A vision has to be laser specific. It can't be, we are here to establish a Sunday school, heal the sick, help the poor, and we also want to have a wonderful music, we want to help the elders. That is not a vision. That's a multitasking that will never work with the vision. Vision has to be laser specific. We are here for one thing, and that thing is what Jesus lived for and died for and left us for and gave us the Holy Spirit for. See people saved and see people saved for the glory of God. Can somebody say amen? A vision, not only it has to be clear, a vision always has to be repeated. People are like boats. If you put them in the middle of the ocean, they won't stay in the middle. They will drift. It takes 1 month and the church will drift from the vision if the pastor, if the leadership does not repeat and brainwash people with that vision. When do they stop? Never. Because it's a human capacity to drift. If our pastor will not remind us within few months, we will lose the vision. Because that's how we are. We are always drifting to the latest fads. And you always need somebody who will cast the same vision all the time. Now we've become like that, where we cast the vision. You probably sat in the three services and you saw. We are like a broken tape recorder. The same thing. Everybody gets up and the same thing. New people come in, they get saved first service, and they already doing the same thing. Because when you cast it long enough, it creates a snowball effect where it becomes automatically for people to believe what you're saying. Another thing about the vision is the vision of the church or the vision of your life always has to be supported by your organizational structure. The challenge happens with the vision is every church has a vision to save souls. As long as saving souls is a department. I remember I came to one young man and I said, what are you guys doing to bring people into salvation? He said, hey, Lucy, come over here. I said, well, Lucy, you're evangelist. Lucy is the one that handles our evangelism. I am pastor. She handles the evangelism. He is the worship leader. She is the Sunday school teacher. And this guy is in charge of the parking lot. And this person is in charge of the media. And every month we switch off. Now, I just described to you a typical church. And I told him one thing. I said, where did you see where Jesus said that you can save souls without first seeking souls? You are divided. Bible says seek and save. You can't save if you don't seek. Evangelism and salvation of souls is not a department. It's a direction. As long as it's a department in our church, people will never be saved continuously. If it's a department, means every department in our church works for a direction. The vision is a direction, not a department. This is not like, oh, we are on this spiritual move right now for next few months about souls. And next week we're going to go on prayer. And the week after that, we'll go on healing. The week after that, we'll go on the children's ministry. That will never work. As long as it's a department instead of a direction, it won't last. Can somebody say amen? You have to make it a direction. Sunday school works for this direction. Youth ministry works for this direction. People on the cameras work for this direction. People on the worship team work for this direction. People who are greeters work for this direction. Pastor works for this direction. Everyone works. Even the church mice has to work for that direction. Can somebody say amen? A vision is where everything starts. Let me just quickly give you a few other thoughts. The second one is the sacrifice. After the vision, God gives David a promise. We know that David begins to take a sacrifice. His sacrifice that David had to make is that David had to get off of his lazy, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, and go get it. Many of us think that if I'm just gonna think it, if I'm just gonna name it, blame it, name it or blab it, name it, confess it. If I'm just gonna sit here and just think positive and just speak positive and feel positive, then all of the people, and I'll open the church doors, people will just come and blessings will come. If I will just sit eating my Cheetos in my couch playing video games, my wonderful husband or wife will come into the door and knock like in that video Louis did. That never happens. You have to pay a price and you have to begin to take risks and you have to sacrifice. And it's the hardest to sacrifice when you have not seen God do anything yet. It's so easy to sacrifice when God fills your boat that was so empty with fish. Oh, of course it's not hard to give up that boat because you've seen God touch the boat. But when God never touched it yet and you have to take a step of faith not knowing, will it work? I've never had this happen to me. But when you try it once and you see God meet you in that sacrifice, you will do it again. And if you keep taking steps of sacrifice, you will see God meeting you in those steps. Can somebody say amen? You know, it happened even with our church. A lot of us, we encourage in our church personally, as personal and as a church, to live a life of sacrifice. For me, honestly, it started about 2.5 years ago. I lived my life financially speaking, tithing to my church, the local church. My father drilled it into me. This was not an option. This wasn't the whole, you know, it's a Old Testament thing. When you're in my house, it's a Savchuk thing. We tithe, period. You want to be blessed? You're going to be in my house. You're going to have to tithe. And that's how I lived. But when it comes to giving sacrificially to God, that wasn't really the vibe of my life. Until about 2.5 years ago, I was speaking at one particular place for a whole week. I had to provide for my food, for my own transportation. And I knew that when I would come there, that I will receive a blessing, an honorarium. And right away before I got there, Holy Spirit placed on my heart, for the first time this happened. And I knew the amount that will come. And it will be a blessing to me and it could help me with the ministry and everything else. And the Holy Spirit placed on my heart, I confirmed it with my wife, not to take it but to give it back to that ministry and to trust that God will meet my needs. And I was like, well, that's gonna rip off. You know, I'm gonna go in there, serve and just reject it. That's not cool. I mean, I like to give when they give and run when they hit and stuff. So I'm gonna take it. But I decided to decline it. And then it led to something else. Instead of going to missions trip, to pay for the missions trip, the same amount of money that I should go to send that money into that missions group so they will bring it to the missionaries in that country. And then it led to, when I was actually in flying to California to our friend's church, a revival church, and it was in the airplane. I remember it like yesterday. I was listening to a sermon by a pastor from another country who was saying that when his ministry was at its lowest, things were so struggling, his mom died and passed on an apartment that was worth $10,000, and he decided to take that apartment and sell it. He sold it for $10,000 and take that money and go and give it into the kingdom of God, asking God for God to give him breakthrough. And this pastor, I'm listening on the airplane, is saying, he says, up to that point, I have never seen God give me breakthrough in the area of my finances and the area of my spirituality. He says, it was such a big risk. So as I'm listening and I'm examining my heart, I'm like, you know what? That's me. I am that person. I need a breakthrough. I don't see many people healed in our ministry. I don't see people getting saved at that time in our ministry. Our youth group, you know, was 45, 35 people every Wednesday night. I need a breakthrough from God. And I had about $9,000 because we're trying to save every year $10,000 so we can buy a land to build a house in 5 years. I come back from California and I tell my wife, I said, I feel like we need to take our money and to give them away exactly $10,000. And you know, my wife says, yeah, for sure, let's do it. And I remember when we gave that money away, something inside of me broke. Because see, when you sacrifice, and to me it meant a lot, you cannot have an option of quitting. Because the sacrifice you give screams at you and says, why did you sacrifice if you're gonna quit? It's too early. I will come through the ground and the seeds will sprout. Wait! Because see, do you have the sacrifice? And I remember when that happened, something inside of me that I've never experienced honestly in my life, where I would want to quit, and it's as though there was a sharp spear in my back. It poked me in the back and says, why did you sacrifice if you're going to quit? And it would push me forward again and again and again. To cut the story short, the house, I already gave up the idea. It was built faster than I would have ever built on my own. Things came in and God began to do in a small but stable way miracles in my finances and in my personal, in our general and corporate ministry. We started to teach it to our leaders. And we started to see exactly the same thing. Where people before the weddings will give half of their wedding budget to produce a CD at the church. And go on a limp saying, God, I've never done this before. This is crazy. And have all of their wedding, everything they want, and still bunch of money left. Where people will sacrifice, empty their empty checkings accounts for one simple reason. God, I want to see you move. Not because somebody told them, but because they heard a story. And they said, I'm not copying Pastor Vlad. I'm copying his faith. And when they copy the faith, something begins to happen. Because if you copy what I did or someone else did, it won't work for you. But if we copy the faith, God will give you your own strategy. And you will begin to see the Holy Spirit. Fire always comes as sacrifice. No sacrifice, no fire. If we think we can advance the kingdom of God without sacrifice, we bluffing. God gave up his son. His son gave up his life. The Holy Spirit gave up his comfort to be with us. Most of us who think that the Holy Spirit, it is such an honor for the Holy Spirit to be with us. I was babysitting a particular family's kids who used to come to our church a long time ago. They're these wonderful, wonderful kids. I don't want to prophesy anything negative. Wonderful kids. And I was supposed to babysit them for 2 hours with my wife. I don't do babysitting no more for that reason now. But after babysitting them for 2 hours, I ended up babysitting 4 hours. These kids bit off part of my ear, punched me. I had bruises in my body. I remember when I left that house and I was like, oh my goodness, I did not know that kids could be possessed. These kids aren't crazy. And when I got home next morning, I'm praying and the Holy Spirit softly put it in my heart. And he said, Vlad, can you imagine how it feels for me to be stuck with you for 2,000 years? And I was like, oh God. You know, it's a sacrifice for the Holy Spirit to be with you all the time. Everything about the kingdom of God is a sacrifice. Don't think you can trick. We can't think that Jesus advanced his kingdom by just drinking soda and having people massage his feet. There was a sacrifice involved. Disciples who expanded the kingdom of God, all except John, sacrificed their life. Some were crucified upside down. Some were skinned. Some were thrown from high buildings head down. Some were speared to death. Some were beheaded. Some were sawn in two. All these guys knew one thing. If you ever want to move the kingdom of God an inch, you're going to have to sacrifice. This whole thing, I need to get it easy. And if God doesn't move right now and I cannot handle one more day, I'm going to die. That stuff has to end in kindergarten. You have to step it up. Be mature. Be a violent man who takes it by force. Can somebody say amen? Write down number three. Is prayer. Is that we have to pray. David prayed and then God answered him. When all of this was going down, David prayed. There's a big focus in prayer. Every church that sees revival is the church that moves mightily in prayer. From Dr. Yonggi Cho to awesome men and women of God all around. And when our pastor started to encourage our vision to be sharp a laser, another thing that started to happen, you know, we used to cancel prayer meetings and not burden people, because when you have a lot of prayers, people are so tired. And I've recognized one thing. People are not tired of prayer. They are tired of pointless prayer. When there is no vision, prayer will be tiring. When you have a vision, you have a reason to have prayer. I remember when we added Tuesday night prayer. Oh, such a burden. Just one night and then move from Tuesday to Friday night. What will people, there's a new movie come out. Oh, people will not come for prayer. People will go watch movies. But when you have a vision, you have a reason for prayer. People start coming for Friday. We say, you know what? Hey, we need to do once a week, do a Wednesday morning, 6:30 to 7:30, just an hour of power to pray. And I was like, man, how am I going to wake up at 6:30? That's too early. We started to wake up and started to come for prayer one more day. And some people said, oh, it's just one more time, one more thing to go to church for. But see, when you have a vision, like a bull, you push through it, because it's not prayer for the prayer's sake. It's prayer for the vision's sake. I remember in the last conference, it was 4 months ago, our pastor says, we need to do prayer every single morning, Monday to Friday. I almost had a heart attack. I was like, I can come. Because if I don't, pastor will fire me. But what about people? Who will come? We started to have that prayer. And pastor would come at 4 a.m. The rest of us will come at 5. And then the rest of the people would come at 7. Some will come even 4:30. And it's been 4 months. And Monday to Friday. And maybe there's about from 50, sometimes up to 60 people throughout that time who will come for prayer. Why is it possible? Not because necessarily they're most disciplined. When you throw the vision, people will follow with prayer. When prayer is for the sake of prayer, it becomes meaningless. It has to be for the sake of vision. Can somebody say amen? When Jesus was going to the cross and he was spending time in prayer, Peter didn't pray. Peter decided to sleep. That's why Peter was slacking and he started slipping. You know, Jesus changed Peter's name and he called him Peter all his life. Peter's name used to be called Simon. Simon means reed. Simon means unstable. You know, the only time that Jesus called Peter Simon is when Peter was sleeping instead of praying. Why? Because this will be the time Peter will act like Simon. When you don't pray, you will act like the old you. I don't care how many Bible verses you memorized. I don't care how many times you've been to the church and how many Hungry Generation t-shirts you bought. It does not matter how many wristbands you got and how many conferences you went to. But if Jesus is praying for his vision and you are slacking and sleeping and say, I'm just too tired, I don't have time. Listen, you will not act like Peter. You will act like Simon. And God wants you not to do that. Can somebody say amen? And the last thing is that we have to expect supernatural. We have to expect supernatural. To advance the kingdom of God, you got to expect constantly God to move in a supernatural ways. We cannot have supernatural if we constantly criticize it. The Bible says, desire spiritual gifts. Now, in my limited 29-year-old undeveloped brain, I cannot comprehend how can you desire miracles if you listen to people on podcasts who criticize them, make fun of them, and you constantly joke about people and mock, laugh people who move in miracles. How can you desire supernatural if everyone who moves in supernatural you have a problem with? We can't have supernatural operating through our life until we begin to honor supernatural in someone else's life. Can somebody say amen? Before Jesus had miracles in his life, there was John who had a thriving ministry. There was no miracles, but the Holy Spirit was using John. And Jesus comes to John's ministry and comes in humbly. He doesn't come and say, I am the Messiah. John, get down here. Untie my shoes right now. He doesn't come to John and say, John, you did it good. You introduced everybody. Now I'll take over from here. No, Jesus comes to John and says, John, can you baptize me? You're the Messiah. The Holy Spirit is without measure on your life. How could you ask me to baptize you? See, Jesus shows us a principle. If you want the Holy Spirit, when did Holy Spirit came upon Jesus? When John, who is lesser than Jesus, is baptizing our Lord Jesus Christ. See, we have this mindset today, God will use me. And the fact that God is using the person on the side, I don't respect that because they eat locust wild honey and they dress funky. What if you cannot come to John and ask him to baptize you? The Holy Spirit has a closed heaven, cannot come down on you. If Holy Spirit came upon Jesus, not when he was praying or fasting, he came upon Jesus when he was submissive and honoring to someone else's miracle led by the Holy Spirit. There's about 95% of us here who will need to find John, and only few people here who actually will be John. Most of us will not be the John. Most of us will be like the Jesus. The John is doing something and you will come and you will get baptized, meaning you will come and you say, you know what, I want to sit, I want to receive, I want to catch the Spirit. I don't want to copy your guys' style. I want to catch the Spirit. When our pastor did that to us, he would send us to Ukraine to sit for 2 weeks, not to copy a style, but to get baptized, to catch the Spirit. And there, many times, even in Ukraine, on the 23rd floor in the apartment at 2 in the morning, the Holy Spirit will drop just this reality of how important it is to win souls. And I come back burning on fire. Why? Because my pastor sent me to John. And then this Saturday, I'm going back. In 2 months, he's sending us to Dr. Yonggi Cho's church. Why? So that we can see how they do home group. No, it's so that we can go to John and say, John, dunk us into water, because there is a calling inside of us as well, and we want it to be activated. Don't be fooled. Don't be fooled. There's only 5% of us or less who are John. The rest of us need to find a John. Only few of us actually have this ability to be able to drive by ourselves. Most of us, even in the area of our finances, in the area of relationships, we need to find someone, a counselor, a mentor, a home group leader, a pastor, or someone else who is further where you are at today and saying, you know what, I'm not here to copy you. I'm just here to catch the spirit, to catch the vision. That's what I do personally. When the Holy Spirit made it clear to me about this personally, my pastor, he would give me hints and I wouldn't get it. That for my spirit to be sharp with supernatural, I have to watch what I listen and what I read. Because my problem before was this: I wanted to be balanced. I wanted to know everything about everyone everywhere. I wanted to be balanced, so I would listen to this, to this, and then there's nothing wrong with listening to all of that. But when you begin to allow everything to influence, so you listen to this guy who says miracles, God doesn't really do miracles today, and God wants people to be sick to teach them a lesson. Then you listen to the other guys like, sickness is from the devil, devil wants to kill you with the sickness. And then you're like, you know what, this guy is right and this guy is right, I'm gonna be balanced. Guess what will happen to you? You will not believe in nothing. You will be confused. Half of the time you'll not know what you believe. And that was what's going on with me before. At one time, my father, who has beehives in his backyard, he gave me a jar of honey. That would have been a gift. My father-in-law didn't know that I already had a jar of honey. He also gave me a jar of honey. And when I receive gifts, I try to keep myself quiet, not to hinder other people from giving. And a wonderful leader of ours, Alex, he came to my office once and he gave me a jar of honey. And so I had 3 jars of honey. I placed them on my desk, and to my interesting surprise, all 3 jars of honey looked different and tasted different, and all 3 were honey. Why? Were they all produced by different species? No, they were produced by honey. The difference between every honey was that a bee would eat of a different tree and a different plant, and it will produce a different type and appearance of honey. And I believe it's a lesson for us. Whatever you eat will begin to happen in your own life. If you constantly feed yourself with every single thing, nothing will happen. But when you become sharp, when it comes to supernatural, and you say, you know what, I love the Holy Spirit, I do not want to know everything and everyone, I want to know the Holy Spirit, I want to preach the gospel, I want to heal the sick, I want to cast out demons, and I want to live in a breakthrough in God. And that's who I'm gonna listen to. And if those guys believe in preaching the gospel but don't like to cast out demons and want to keep demons in people, don't like to pray for the sick, don't believe in breakthrough, awesome, keep them for someone else. But I need food that will produce the same results that was in my Lord Jesus Christ. Can somebody say amen? Expect supernatural. Somebody say, expect supernatural. We live today in a world, in America, in Europe, where supernatural is no longer necessary. And who made that happen is when Emperor Constantine, when he became the emperor, he stopped church's persecution. And when church was persecuted, they couldn't get educated. They didn't have diplomas, they didn't have people in the government, they didn't have connections, they didn't have a lot of money. What they had is the Holy Spirit. And He was enough. He helped them to get through the thickest and the hardest persecutions. The church multiplied like crazy. People were getting saved, people were getting baptized, raised from the dead. And the Holy Spirit was the main center of the church. When Constantine came, he did something really wonderful. He removed the persecution, and with that came something really horrible. The church no longer needed the Holy Spirit to move forward. We shifted to universities, which are amazing. We shifted to seminaries, which is very important. We shifted to politicians and priests who became popular. Pope and bishops who became very notable, and people became bishops and popes, and people became priests at the time because it was the cool thing to do in the culture. And the Holy Spirit, when He is not expected and needed, He slowly walks away. And that's where mid ages came. That's where dark ages came. That's where church started going corrupt. Church started developing a lot of weird ideas. Why? Because without the Holy Spirit, at first it's comfortable, which leads to complacency and that leads to compromise. It's like the Chinese Christians who came to America, and upon leaving the American airport, they asked them, so what did you guys think about American Christians? What did you guys think about the Christians living in the United States? What did you think about their faith, their generosity? And they looked with these gazing eyes upon us Americans, and they said, we are so shocked with how much you guys can do without God. Take the Holy Spirit away, and most of the services won't change at all. Take the Holy Spirit away from the book of Acts, and there will be no book of Acts. Which simply means, that does not mean we need to ask for persecution. Please understand, I don't like persecution, don't want it. But can we not wait for persecution to be desperate for the Holy Spirit? Do we always need persecution to be hungry for the Holy Spirit? Can we be educated and still hungry? Can we be prosperous and still desperate for God? Can we be a generation who say, God, I have a medical insurance, but I also have faith in a healer who is credited medical insurance? Let's be a generation who will answer Paul's request, desire supernatural. You're blessed, maybe everything is fine. Be hungry for supernatural on somebody else's behalf. Because my friend, God will have to wake us up. But I believe if we can wake up on our own, maybe He won't have to. I choose to wake up on my own. I choose to wake up in myself a desire to say, God, I need your supernatural. I'm healthy. You prosper me. You gave me health. You gave me a wonderful wife. You gave me a wonderful mentors. But God, I need more of your supernatural, because 260,000 people in Tri-Cities will never know God if I don't have your supernatural. They don't want to come and hear a Russian preacher with an accent who misspells or mispronounces his words. They want to come because the Holy Spirit is real. Can somebody say amen? And so we're going to sacrifice. We're going to have a vision. We're going to pray. And we're going to expect the supernatural. Can somebody say